First, let me say Colin is a brilliant guy, one of the smartest guys I know in the business. You just talk to him and you start getting all these ideas about how you can tweak your conversions. And he's just a copywriting and persuasion, you know, master at this point. A lot of people follow him. He's also a great person in terms of like building a huge cult-like following. You know, he has true fans that buy everything he puts out, which enables him to live his dream lifestyle of playing Legos and video games and hanging out with his kids. So
I'm not gonna lie, Ron. I literally was just playing with Legos. And
so more formally, his bio. I probably should put this on the screen so you guys can read along. It's like unbelievable. The Reverend Dr. Sir Colin D. Terrio. He's not just a retired copywriter and premier collector of phony titles, which he bought online. He's also a sought-after professional liar and public speaker. Most famously, however, Colin is also the founder and current leader of the Cult of Copy, a secretive organization of over 15,000 professional and hobbyist persuasion agents placed in all 50 U.S. states and her territories, as well as over 100 other entirely non-strategic countries and commonwealths around the world. Rumor has it that using a homemade rocket, they have recently taken control of an abandoned World War II era Nazi moon base for which they broadcast the secrets of persuasion, influence, mind control, and marketing so that the people of Earth might one day be free from their invisible puppet masters. If that's not like a great intro, I don't know what it is. So Colin, come on and drop the science, man. Tell us about persuasion.
So yeah. Basically what I do for a living is write stuff like that nonsense you just read, and it's a very good living. So I know most of the people listening to this are, you know, paid writers, as in you write as a service. And what I am going to talk about is how I used to do that. I used to be a professional copywriter, first as an employee at a company, and then I went freelance for a couple of years. And what I did right away was by creating content around what I was doing as a working professional writer, I built up an audience of other professional and hopeful professional writers. And through serving that audience, I was able to completely retire from writing as a service. So now the only things I write are whatever I feel like writing, and I post it mostly to Facebook and a couple of other places. But basically, all I do is talk about a topic I really enjoy, which is persuasion and influence and all that stuff that I wrote into that intro. And I get, you know, really nice six-figure income that grows every year just from doing that. And all I have to do is talk about something I like talking about anyway. So not that you have to imitate that subject if you want to do what I did, but I'm going to talk about some things that I teach to people as far as taking your knowledge and skill as a writer and being able to turn that into a business, whether you want it to add on to the money you make providing writing as a service in whatever avenue you do that, or you want it to replace client work like I did, is up to you, but it will make you less reliant on what can be ups and downs when you serve clients. So if that sounds interesting to everybody, we'll dive in. What you see on your screen is a mind map, all of the products that I make, which I will talk about as part of this presentation, look just like this. I'm way too lazy to make very pretty looking slides, and usually the way I organize my thoughts to do any kind of product or training like we're doing now, start out as a mind map. It's how I think, it's how I organize my ideas, and what I found is you don't really have to do a whole lot beyond that if you can explain your ideas clearly when you're doing a presentation. So that's a tip for you there, is you don't necessarily have to use a whole lot of polish if your audience can appreciate the content even in a raw format, which I know you all can because you're all pros, right? So it doesn't need to be pretty, it just has to be awesome. And hopefully you think this presentation is awesome. So the first thing I want to talk about is what sort of started me down my path is this idea called 1,000 True Fans, and probably you've heard about it. It was a big deal for a while. I think it first came out in 2008, and it was originally an article by this guy, Kevin Kelly, and I think it was originally on the Technium blog, but it's something I read way back then when I was still an employee, and it just sort of stuck with me and resonated really well. And for those who don't know it, if you're not familiar with it, excuse me, the original formula was he defined a true fan as someone who follows you, someone in your audience who buys everything that you offer. So anything that you could think of to sell them, they'll buy. They're just that much of a rabid fan of what it is that you do and what you're all about. His idea was that if you create only $100 worth of products a year and you have 1,000 true fans, then you have a nice six-figure business, right? Now, he was originally doing this for artists and musicians, right? That's who he was sort of talking to as far as creating $100 worth of product a year and having 1,000 true fans. And for artists and musicians, they typically have like a $20 price range for what they put out, you know, an album of songs, a cheap little book of artwork, generally going to fall within the $20 range. For those of us who sell ebooks online, whether on Kindle or PDFs or whatever, they tend to mimic print book cover prices within the, you know, $20 and under kind of range, right? What was funny is at the time this guy published this article, so many people just kind of poo-pooed it and dumped all over it saying, you know, oh, how can I make $100 worth of product to sell in a year? That's absurd. And I thought it was absurd to think that you could only make $100 worth of product at the time, because I was working for guys that were selling information products, and like the information products we were selling cost $2,000 a piece. So just selling one exceeded, you know, $100 worth of product a year. But I guess these guys being musicians, they're thinking of like studio rental and equipment to go tour, and it just seemed like impossible for them to think that they could even create $100 worth of product in a year. But I started thinking of an alternate version where, like, if you had only 100 true fans, which is super easy on social media. Most people I know have at least 100 Facebook friends, if not many, many more. So if you get 100 true fans and make $1,000 worth of product a year, the math would work out the same way. I could have a six-figure business and not have to work that hard, because all I have to do is keep feeding the true fans the kind of stuff they want. So if you want to get to $1,000 worth of product per year that you're putting out that people can buy from you and support your leisurely Lego lifestyle like I have, you need a high-value customer. So for us, we want someone who's going to be able to get a bigger return on their investment of buying your stuff, because if you want to, you know, make something expensive, the customer has to get that amount of value out of what you sell. And people are willing to spend more if it's valuable information that they can use that will give them a bigger return. So for us as writers, if you are learning how to make money as a writer, how to live a writer's lifestyle and get paid to do that, which obviously you are because you're here, you are the kind of person that spends money to learn this stuff. There are many of you, right? If you are learning it and doing it, and you create content about what you're doing, that's your audience, right? The people that you currently think of as competitors are your future customers when you do what I'm going to advise as part of this talk, which is to immediately turn around and teach people what it is that you're doing that's working, right? You're sort of become a journalist, keeping track of your own success and your trials and tribulations, things you're trying, things that work, things that don't work, things you bought that you like, things you bought that you hated. You just basically tell people what you're doing, and that's where your audience comes from, because that material is valuable and people will pay you for it because you are doing things that they don't have the time to do. You're making the decisions that they don't have to explore because you helped them out and made them for them. So I mostly make $100 products. So just like this mind map you're looking at here, I do trainings that are one problem, one solution trainings. For example, like a sales letter template or a video script template. I'll do an hour-long webinar. They usually end up being longer than that because I like to talk a lot, in case you didn't notice yet. But these trainings are for pros, so they're unpolished. They're just pure content. We get right into it. Not a lot of fluff. There's not a lot of sales material because they paid $100 to attend. It's already sold, right? We'll talk more about the way that I do these products before we get to the end of the talk. But these products are worth $100 to them because what they are things that they can turn around as copywriters and use to serve their clients for many, many more multiples than $100. So it's well worth it for them to pay that amount. And $100 is more than most people are used to making for low-end information products. But it's super easy to deliver on that value, and I'll tell you how a little later. But just to give you an idea, once you build up this audience, I write and talk about persuasion and influence and conversion, right? So these are other things that I've sold to the audience, even though initially all I wanted to sell them were the trainings that I just talked about. So I've sold merchandise like t-shirts, because people think the group is cool and we have a logo, and we have little inside jokes and things, so I sold the t-shirt. I made a t-shirt design and sold a bunch of those. I always include that one because I just did it as a fluke. Like, I wanted a cool t-shirt, so I made it available to other people and I sold a bunch. So I always thought that was interesting that as a writer, I sold a bunch of t-shirts. I also do consulting. I don't do it so much anymore, but I used to sell critiques, which is instead of me writing your material for you, you get someone else to write it, and I'll look at it and tell you what you need to fix to make it more effective, right? So that was a fun service because I got paid to read what other people got paid less to write and work really hard on, so that was always fun for me. I sell mentoring to people who want to do what I've done and sort of build up your own fan audience and make a living serving them, and I've also been paid to speak, like I mentioned in my little intro that I wrote for Ron to read. Just to give you an idea of all the things you can do, I know it seems weird if you're just starting out as a writer and you barely maybe make a living writing. What you learn and what you're able to do as a writer once you make it click and you start making a living at it, these are all things that are possible for you to sell when you build up your own audience. So lots of opportunities to go well beyond writing. So how do you do this if you're not like the expert? Because most people think if you want to build up a huge audience, you need to be an expert in your field from the moment you start, right? Like, no one's going to want to follow you if you're not the master at doing what you're doing, but that's just not true. The bellwether effect is something that I coined the term, but I'll explain what it means in a minute. But it's also called leading from the middle. And you're doing basically what I talked about in the 100,000 true fans model. You are not advanced very far beyond the audience that you're building up. So you're not the guru at the top of the mountain. You're climbing the same mountain that your audience is. You're just a couple of steps ahead of them, and you're telling them, you know, don't step in that hole. Don't trip over that rock. The information you have is valuable, but you're not light years ahead of them. So they can see themselves doing what you're doing because you're sharing with them what you're doing and making it easy to follow, right? So you don't declare yourself a leader, and what you basically do is you're blazing your own trail, but by the simple fact that you are going to be an action taker and you're going to turn around and tell people about the actions you're taking, what worked, what didn't work, and all of that, you become a leader because people follow you. You don't declare yourself the leader. But if you make yourself easy to follow and you're doing interesting things, people are going to want to follow along. So let me open this one. The bellwether. A bellwether is a sheep. It's a kind of sheep. Before I explain that sheep metaphor and why it's called the bellwether effect, one other thing I wanted to note is the kind of people who watch the sheep, right? So if you think of your audience as sheep, I know some people find that to be an insulting metaphor, but let's just go with it for now. Pretend your audience are sheep, right? So the kind of people that typically pay attention to the sheep that make their living off of exploiting or consuming these sheep, you have the shepherd, who you would think of that as like your legitimate, benevolent guru type person who really wants to help people. They've mastered whatever it is they're about and they just want to help people, right? That's the shepherd. Takes care of the sheep, doesn't hurt them. The sheepdog is typically the kind of person that works for the sheep, right? They don't do anything new. They're not creative. They're not helping, but they, you can think of that as like the affiliate market. Like they don't make their own new products, but they serve the audience by promoting the things that the shepherds make. But then you also have wolves, and wolves are the scammers and the people who are selling get-rich-quick schemes, and in the health and beauty industry, they're selling all kinds of potions and pills and shortcuts and all of those kind of things. And basically, they don't care if the customer buys and then never buys again. They just want more and more customers, and people who follow that model tend to have to jump from business to business because once they burn a customer, that customer's burned for life. This is a whole different model, where we want the benefits of what the shepherd gets, being an expert and having his own flock, but we don't want the work and responsibility of being a shepherd, and we don't really need to build up our own little bunch of sheepdogs to help keep our audience in check. So what we want to be is like the, one of the sheep in the flock, but we want to be the boss sheep. So that's where the term bellwether comes from, because a bellwether, the wether is a male sheep that's, you know, not to get too technical with the farming terms, but it's been gelded, it's been castrated. That's the boss sheep of the flock, right? So it's like the alpha male that all the other sheep follow. But the trick is, he doesn't know he's the leader necessarily, and the other sheep don't even really know he's the leader. Because the way sheep work is they sort of just stand around bored, looking for something to do. They stand around, you know, eating the grass right in front of their face, and then suddenly the sheep on the side of them moves 2 feet to the left. So that sheep is like, oh, that looks cool, I'm going to do that. So that sheep moves 2 feet to the left and starts eating the grass there. The sheep on the side of that sheep sees that happen on, you know, this is terribly exciting. I was bored eating this grass. I'm going to move 2 feet over and eat that grass. So they move like in a ripple pattern, right? And the trick is whichever sheep gets bored first is the leader because he moves first, and then all the other sheep follow suit. But the problem is he's not in front saying, hey, sheep, follow me. This is cool. Let's go over here. He's in the middle. And it can be hard to figure out where the flock of sheep is going to go unless you identify that sheep, the one that moves the fastest, and then you put a bell on his neck. So he's the bellwether because when he moves, he rings. All the other sheep are going to follow that sheep. So even if he's in the middle of the flock, the shepherd just has to listen for where that sheep is going to move. You follow the bell, that's where the whole flock is going to go. So that's the concept of what a bellwether is and why it's useful to do that. So what you want to do in your market is position yourself as a bellwether. You're not a guru. You're not the master. You're a person just like your audience who is executing and learning and doing and getting results and trying to succeed at your mutual interest that you share with your audience. But you're the one who moves first. And you make it easy to follow along with what you're doing because the content you share shows what you're doing. So you end up having a large flock of people who are interested in what you do, following along with you without you having to, you know, position yourself as something you're not or pretend you have experience that you don't necessarily have. You don't have to fake anything. You can be 100% honest, and you will build up an interested audience around what you do. Now, the trick is, over time, you get better at what it is that you do. You learn more, you practice more, you become more skilled. Eventually you will be more of a master at whatever it is that is your chosen, you know, pursuit. The audience who's been following along from the beginning, some of them are going to be very successful and, you know, give you credit for helping them along the way. But for new people coming in, they see you as this expert, but if they go back and dig, you've created a living before and after record of your evolution from your humble beginnings to your awesome present that only seems to get better and better. So unlike other people who maybe provide information about what it is that you do, they feel like yours is more factual and more applicable, and they know it works because you're proof that it works because you've been showing them the whole time. So that's why I say if you're going to do this, if your goal is eventually to have such an audience following you and listening to your recommendations and buying your training and paying you for your advice, start it today, even though you're just a beginner. Learn something valuable, do it, record it, share it, and then for advanced stuff, you teach it and you sell it. And again, it may seem counterintuitive, but even if you're just slightly ahead of the audience that you're selling to, it's still valuable for them to learn from you because you actually know what the landscape looks like directly in front of them versus some guru who's been doing it for years and is maybe 10 years away from having to deal with what for you are everyday problems. Let's see. So that's the bellwether effect. Hopefully everybody understands that. If you have any sheep-related questions, save them till then. We'll make sure.
Yes, thank you for the agricultural and marketing lessons. But that's really great. I mean, and we're getting lots of good feedback that the analogy is very powerful. And, yeah, we all think we have to be the expert, and we might have to pretend we're something we're not. But, yeah, people want to learn from somebody. I like how you said, like, you know, the person who is the action taker, people follow that person. And how, you know, eventually you do become that expert and you have all these people following you who are now, you know, they're your testimonials because they've been following you this whole time and they've achieved some great results. It's perfect.
Yes, exactly, exactly. I frequently have people who will tell me things when I say, oh, well, building up your audience is easy. You just do a little bit every day and blah, blah, blah. And now you can sell information products and generate cash whenever you want. And they're like, oh, Colin, that's easy because you have a huge audience. And I'm like, well, they weren't huge on the first day. I've just been doing it every day for like 3 years. So it's not going to get smaller if I work on it every day. It's only going to get bigger and bigger and easier and easier. But if I had waited until I was the expert and said, okay, now I want an audience of 15,000 people, that I would have wasted a lot of time. I could have started from day one, which I did. I started doing this as soon as I went freelance. And built my audience alongside my expertise, and eventually I quit having to sell my time for money as a service provider.
Yeah, and I mean, you're doing it with copywriters and copywriting, but I mean, this translates to anybody, like weight loss or wanting to get into better shape, if it's fitness or something, or finance.
Yes, at a minimum, I'm not saying every topic that you can think of would be something that could support your entire life, but at a minimum, any hobby that you have that's something that you spend money to pursue is something that you could follow this formula and at a minimum subsidize the money you spend to pursue that hobby. So by simply sharing what you do to pursue that hobby in a public way so that people can follow along, you should be able to make at least enough money to where you're not coming out of pocket and anything you want to buy pertaining to that hobby is free for you to share with the audience. Here are the last two things I want to talk about. The first two are sort of philosophical, and these are more tactical, right? So the four whys is a formula that you can use for really selling anything to anyone. You can use it in content. You can use it in emails. You can use it in actual deliberate sales material. But not just for products, but for yourself. And it's really just four simple questions. In anything you write, if you answer these four questions, it will cultivate the readers to become fans. The people in that audience who would just normally be a passive reader and move on to the next thing, now all of a sudden you're giving them hooks like Velcro that stick to them and make them want to read a little more. And then when they read a little more, they're stuck a little closer and so on. And it keeps building, right? And super simple. Just remember to answer these four questions. So the four questions are, why me, why you, why this, and why now? So when you're trying to build an audience, you are interacting with them. Like you are a visible character in their life. You are a persona. They don't know you probably in real life. They only interact with you online. But you are a person who is known to them. Like you're not writing an article with no voice. They know that you are the person creating that content. So what you need to do is, that's the why you, sorry I skipped ahead, but it doesn't matter because you can answer them in any order. Why are you the one to deliver this message to them and what connection do you have with this product? Why you, right? if you are a person who is pursuing a professional writing career, that's why you. If your subject is about writing, that's why you are the right person to be talking about it. That is your connection to the topic. Then why me? Why are you bothering them? Like, presumably, in this scenario, it's because you have somehow been able to identify them as being someone who is interested in becoming a professional writer, whether this is done via a targeted ad, or you're in a topic-specific group, or you're just posting on your Facebook wall because you are professionally and socially connected to people interested in that topic. You just need to give them a reason so that they understand why you are bothering them. Why are you talking to me? What, of all the people on earth you could be telling this to, why are you telling it to them? Why this? Whatever topic or subject it is that you are writing to them about, whether it's a product or a service or just an idea, an angle, whatever it is, why this and not any other thing you can talk about? It should be unique and special and meaningful and not just a little tidbit that won't do anything for them, but it should, no matter what it is, in any message you write, further them in your mutual pursuit, even if it's just like an inch. You know, if it's just a little thought for the day, a little inspirational quote, all of that is just a slight nudge, but it's better than like a cat picture that has nothing to do with anything. So always be thinking of like what is it that I can share that's going to push people, whether by an inch or by a mile? And that's why this. That's why whatever it is that you're sharing with them is valuable to them. And you can express that to them. Explain why it is. And then why now? This is the big one that really brings the marketing into it. Why is this message urgent? Why can't they wait or hesitate? Why do they need to get into the habit of stopping what they're doing and reading what you posted immediately when they encounter it? I happen to like posting on Facebook a lot. Most of my stuff is done on Facebook because Facebook is one of those things that people give priority to anyway. You know, if I can make that little red number on the globe ding a little higher, they're going to go check it out because they would rather do that than whatever boring thing they have to otherwise be doing. But you want to give them an explicit reason. So if you're doing a promotion for a product, why today? Why does it have to be today? So like in the case of this summit that you're attending now, why today is because that's when we're doing it. It's being recorded live. It had to be today. So when you got emails from Ron and Alice last week saying, hey, we need to tell you about this, the why now was because it's happening next week and you need to buy it now if you want to be part of it, right? So always include a reason why you have to tell them this right now. Why is it today? Why is this important for you? And when you include as many of these as you can, you don't always have to use all four if you can't think of a good way to, but you use them cumulatively and it gives people a reason to understand why they're following you, why they like you, why they care about you as a lens for the information they want to know about. And the reason they start to value you that way is because you're always telling them, I made this just for you. I'm sharing this just with you because you are the person who's interested in this, and I thought you would like it. Here's why it'll help you, and here's why it couldn't wait, right? So it always makes it seem like you are constantly gathering information from all over the internet to give it to them right away because you value them so much. That's the perception it creates when all of your material for your audience answers these four questions explicitly without them having to ask. Hopefully everybody follows along with that, but this is like the simplest sales formula I know, and you can build an audience of infinite size just by including these four ingredients in your messages. And generally speaking, if you can answer these in a promo before the audience can even sort of formulate the question in their mind, what's great about it for long-term messaging is that a lot of people feel like they're scared their audience is going to experience burnout. Like, oh, I don't want to send them a promotion every day. They're going to get mad. If you do it this way, they never get mad because you're giving them a reason why you had to bother them today. So even if they have to say no, they're like, you know, that wasn't for me, but he told me why it was urgent, so I'm not mad at them for bothering me constantly with promotions. It feels much more like you're sharing it with them because you care, as opposed to I'm pushing this in your face because I want you to buy something. But even in general, for non-promotional messages, using these four questions and making sure that your copy answers them will always improve the way that it works on your audience. And then finally, we have the core philosophy that is responsible for all of my success. Pardon my French, but that's what the acronym stands for. It's actually the way that I teach to create products. It's named after a quote from Bill O'Reilly, who was caught on, was it Inside Edition, that tabloid news show he got his start on. And apparently they were recording promos, and the guy with the cue cards kept messing up. And Bill, being the professional he was like, I don't need the script, you guys. I can record it off the top of my head. But he used more colorful language to say that particular information. But what I want to tell you is that as a writer who is used to paying attention to all these meticulous details that I needed to be on top of for my client projects, it was taking me forever to do the things that I wanted to do in my own business, which were create my own products, write my own stuff, build my own audience. And it was because I was treating myself as a client, and I needed to not do that because, like, I'm not one of these people that's a perfectionist where I'm like, oh, it's not good enough, I need to make it better. But I'm an infinite fiddler. So if I like something, I will fiddle with it forever. I'll keep coming up with new cool ideas, and it'll take me like 6 months to make a single slideshow because I keep having fun and I like doing it. And if I don't give myself a hard deadline, I never finish anything. So what I started doing was webinars, much like this one, where I charge people to attend a live webinar, and then I teach them something while we're on that webinar, and then I record it, and then that's my product. I sell the recording as the product. And if I wanted to, I can have someone transcribe it and make pretty slides and strip out the audio and make a voiceover, do all of that stuff and turn it into what most people expect from a fancy info product. I've never had to do that because I only sell to people like myself. But you could do that is the point. But the trick is this pulls your knowledge out of you and makes it into a valuable format in the least possible amount of time. And what's great about it is you waste no time creating products that it ends up no one wants. Because if no one buys your training, then just don't do it. No one knows. No one knows no one bought it. Just don't do it if no one buys it and you didn't waste any time creating any content or product material that no one wanted to buy. But if you're serving your competitors as customers and they can get a big ROI out of what you're selling to the degree that it's worth it for you to charge $100 per ticket, it doesn't take a whole lot of people buying it to make it worth your while. So at the time I was doing this, I was charging a couple of $100 an hour for consulting. So I figured if two people buy and show up, it's worth it for me to show up for that hour and talk about this subject. And what's great is if you do it in front of a live audience and you really do know what you're talking about, they ask questions and make the material even better than it would otherwise be. So basically, they do a lot of the work for you, and you end up only having to do preparation that is as big as this mind map you see in front of you. You don't have to do a whole lot more. You just put it together, get it in front of them in the format that you can share, and just bombard them with your brilliance. You know, read off your mind map, share all the ideas, give them everything that you needed to give them. And like I said, if you focus on one problem, one solution, it makes it really easy to create a deliverable. You guys got to see my Facebook messages popping up there. So here's the key idea behind this philosophy. You perform the material into existence and record it by doing it live in front of an audience. We'll talk about what I use to deliver that. You set the deadline for the presentation and lock it in. So you start charging people to attend, and you know you have to show up in a week and give them the content that you told them you would deliver, right? So there's a hard deadline. You can't fiddle with it forever. At some point, you have to call it done and show up with what you have. And what's great is, like we said, all you have to do is teach what you're learning and doing right now. You don't have to make a survey product that covers all possibilities on your topic. Just simple problem, simple solution, that's something that people will pay for because it helps them, you know, better do their own work and serve their own clients because you're giving them a very simple way to solve a problem that either they or their clients will have. So to do this, the idea is it's a minimum viable product. Like we said, it's raw and uncut because you're making it for fans. It doesn't have to be amazing. It's the same idea as, like, who is it, the Grateful Dead that encouraged their fans to record live shows. So they have tons and tons more material available and recorded for fans to enjoy than the actual albums they put out and sold. But they're all of varying quality, right? Like if a guy's got a little tape recorder in his hand and he's standing in the middle of a field full of screaming fans, it's not going to be the best recording, but the fans don't care because it's about being there and having the recording and it being special and part of an event, right? They participated, so they like that. So it doesn't have to be pretty and polished. That sort of, the aesthetic fits the delivery, I guess is what I'm trying to say there. Like we said, the strength of it is that nothing is produced unless it's been paid for. So if no one's buying it, you don't have to prepare any material, come up with a different pitch. But if enough people buy it to make it worth your while, you have a week to prepare the material, and then you just show up and deliver it, and then it's recorded, and then the product can be sold forever, right? I have products that I recorded 3 years ago. I still sell a few of recordings a month for $200 a piece. And by this point, 3 years in, I have 15 products, I think, total in the catalog. And this year my goal is to do all the work that I've been putting off because I'm lazy and just do things like if you bought product number one, I will send you an email a month later automatically that says, hey, maybe you'll like product two also. Because right now I don't even bother doing that, but I guarantee I would be making a lot more sales if I did, especially since I have 15 products over this time. So hopefully you can see how just using these simple principles alongside being a service-based writer that serves clients, eventually, like very quickly actually, in the first year I was able to pretty much retire from doing client work. I was doing only critiques, and then a year after that I retired from doing client work altogether unless I feel like it. Like now I'll do retainers where I'll still do that consulting and critiquing, but you have to pay me for a full year's worth of critiques up front for me to work with you on that kind of thing. And these products are very simple. I use GoToWebinar, which is what we're using now. And then all it is my PayPal account. I have an AWeber account to collect their email. You can integrate those two through AWeber. And then optionally, I have a WordPress installation. That's what I use to put the download links. But I sometimes don't even do that, and I just give people the webinar registration link directly once they pay. But it doesn't even have to be GoToWebinar. You could do Google Hangouts or any of a variety of other online streaming possibilities. As long as you can lock it down and make sure the only people that can show up are the people who have the direct link that they paid for, that'll work. So super easy, and I want to show you by example here, it does not have to be very complex. It doesn't have to be complicated or pretty or polished if you're putting the right information in front of the audience that can find it valuable. So for you guys, I'm presuming you found this valuable because of where you are in your career, hopefully, and you can see that you found value in what was a very stripped down, very raw, very direct presentation that hopefully you would have paid for if, you know, you would know me and wanted to follow along in doing what I'm doing. So hopefully by example you can see you could do exactly this starting today, and maybe 3 years from now you would have an audience of multiple thousands of people who pay you to talk about a subject that you like and would talk about all day for free. That's it. That's all the material I have prepared. I was only supposed to go a half hour. I did pretty good. I only went 10 minutes over. But
we will pay you over time.
So yeah, any questions, comments, Anything?
You're getting a lot of great feedback. Getting a lot of great feedback. Very valuable, very valuable. Awesome content. Well laid out.
They like your mind map. They're intrigued by that. Yes. And you use FreeMind for that? Someone was asking.
Yeah, I use FreeMind on my laptop. And then I use, I think it's called iThoughts on my iPad. But really what I was looking for is FreeMind uses .mm files. And those are like an open format that every other software uses. If you use, you know, like I think XMind is not cross-compatible unless they specifically code for it. So my goal was just whatever device I use, my iPhone, iPad, laptop, I just want to be able to pass those .mm files in between them. But yeah, I don't try out a bunch of different software. I just picked whichever, you know, I downloaded the first one that said it could do .mm files, and unless it didn't work well, I kept it.
All right. And Sue wanted to know, when you, like, for your products, when you do it live, what's the difference between what you charge for that and then once everything's all put together for...
So what I like to do is, because I want a little bit of a spike in sales when I launch it, I will charge only $100 to attend live, and if you buy a live attendance, you get the recording automatically, right? So even if you can't attend, you still get the recording if you purchase, but then when it's only the recording, I'll let it like die down a week after we do the recording, and then I usually don't talk about that product again for a couple of months, so it's sort of out of people's minds. When I bring it back, it's $200 for the recording, and that's pretty standard. Occasionally I have sales on this product or that product, depending, and I'll knock it down to like $150, but it'll never be only $100 again. So it's always cheapest to buy it when I announce it as being live, even if you only want the recording. So that way I condition people to purchase whatever it is that's brand new that I'm pushing, and then they know they can get the older products out of the catalog at the full price, or if they just wait around, they'll eventually all be on sale.
Right on. Okay, so, I think maybe you're going to share this anyways. Chantel wanted to know what where your Facebook page is. I don't know if you have a Facebook page, but I know you have a awesome Facebook group.
Yeah, if you just search The Cult of Copy on Facebook, you should be able to find it. The URL was like facebook.com/group/cultofcopy. But you have to request to join. But unless you have a really spammy profile or it's completely closed off and I can't look at it to make sure you're not a spammer, I generally approve everyone to join. But yeah, if you like any of this stuff, this is the kind of stuff that I post, but a lot of people share, you know, psychology articles, influence articles, persuasion articles, that kind of thing. It's a very active discussion group, so if you love the topic, it's bottomless. You will get sick of the subject matter before you run out of things to read.
Well, I enjoyed all your... I was your friend on Facebook before I knew your group, and I enjoyed you share stuff there too, but Ron told me that I needed to sign up for the group because you post like amazing things there, and he was absolutely correct. It is a you spend a lot of time studying these things, and you're just posting to Facebook, and it's amazing, like your audience loves you. You post really smart things that, you know, really make you think, and I love it.
Yeah, I mean, I love that my job is basically to read this stuff and think about it and apply it. Like
we're lucky to have people like you. So well, Deborah has a great question. She said, You mentioned you're not a perfectionist. Any tips for those of us who are perfectionists or too busy having fun they want to make everything pretty and perfect, how to get over yourself and get that minimally viable product out there?
Social media is great for that, because what I do is I don't edit anything until after I've posted it. So, like, everything that anyone's ever seen me post online, unless it says edited, you know, if you go back in and change it, it'll note that it's been edited. If you don't see it say that, you're looking at a first draft. The idea there is, you use the post button as the deadline. Once you hit post, then you can edit it if you really want to. But typically, if you're building up an audience as you go, you're too busy interacting with people to really go back through and fiddle with it too much, so you learn to not care as much. And it puts you more on the schedule of what are you going to post next instead of continuing to worry about something you already posted. It helps you really think of it as, you know, that's in the past. What's the new thing? Instead of focusing on something that's already been published. Because really, what you post today is what people are going to read. The typo you posted a week ago, no one cares about. So what it does is it gives you the discipline and the habit of really concerning yourself with creating new and ongoing content, posting more and more every day, and eventually you don't have to fiddle with everything because you get better at stating it the way that you meant to as you type it out the first time. I guess you could sort of think of it as like the perfectionist is like a classical composer, you know, constantly tweaking and retweaking the notes on the paper. But what you want to get good at is more of thinking of yourself as like a jazz performer, right? You want to be good at writing and publishing in the moment and sharing things as they're happening. And then, you know, once you turn it in, once it's posted, you're done. I guess it would be sort of like journalism too. Like if you write for a newspaper or a magazine, once you turn it in, you can't mess with it anymore. Like it's done, it's published. You're moving on to the next thing. Try better next time. If something you publish really bugs you and you wish you had done it a different way, fix it in some future thing that you publish instead of worrying about, you know, what you already did. Does that make sense?
Yes, and Deborah says that your advice is great, and a few other people also responded that answer is good. Yeah, but it's once you, yeah, you just get out there, you do it, and, you know, worry about that later. There are sometimes, you know, people who get upset about typos and things like that, but really, you know, we're human, so what's the point of worrying about those people? Serve the people who are more interested in the message.
Yeah, and I mean, it's good to have big plans and grandiose visions for what you want to do. But I find, like, for example, I knew from the people that I worked for before I freelanced that what I wanted to do was, position myself as this expert so that I could sell information products. And I knew these guys are selling information products for, like, $2,000 a shot. And I knew I didn't have the ability to sit there and create enough content to justify something of that price tag. But by doing my products one piece at a time as one problem, one solution. I did, if anybody's familiar with the Voltron cartoon from the 80s, I call it the Voltron, where I knew I was doing individual pieces that later on I can bundle them all together into one big giant thing. So I have a sales letter template, I have email templates, I have a video script template, I have a webinar template. Those things solve problems individually in a valid way, but if I bundle them all together, I can easily make like a $2,000 mega copy course that covers pretty much everything anyone in the IM industry is going to ask a writer to try and write, you know, to hire you. So I got my audience to subsidize the creation of my big giant mega product bit by bit as I went along. So it's good to have the big grandiose plans, but think about how you can break it down into tiny pieces that will add together. And that ties back into the Legos, I guess. I think of things like Legos. Every little piece is an individual piece, but they all lock together if I want them to. Does that make sense?
Yep.
It does. Yes. All right. So lots of great feedback. Fantastic webinar. Many thanks for Colin for being so real and down to earth. Nice. Lots of great feedback here.
Awesome. Well, thanks, okay. Everybody.
Yep. Thank you, Colin. That was awesome. I'm so glad I invited you to, so glad we invited you to join on this. You just added a completely different flavor that nobody's talking about, and it's just perfect. for our audience?
Well, thanks for having me, guys. I really appreciate it. Obviously, I love talking about this stuff. If anybody wants to continue the conversation, you know where to find me. And anybody needs anything else?
Yep. Cult of Coffee. A lot of people asked, and I answered the question, but just search for Cult of Coffee in Facebook.
Yeah, and I have cultofcoffee.com, but that's like under construction.
For how long has it been under construction?
You know, like a year and a half. You know,
I like to
take my time. You can get to the group and the YouTube channel from there, and I intend to start posting more and more content. Like I said, that's my 2016 goal is to was the guy before me Daniel. Yeah, so he said about like taking the content you already have and repurposing it. Well, I have a ton of products and a ton of posts that I've built up in my group over the years, so now I have a blog where I'm going to dig through the archive and repost stuff that I wrote, you know, as much as 3 years ago and put it in public to grow my group, because none of them have ever seen it, and it's buried in the group.
Yeah.
So I can just drag it up and reuse it and not have to write anything new. In fact, I'm trying to force myself to not create any new products this year, because when I get bored, I just create a new product. So I'm going to try and do that to force myself to make sure I'm building all the things to help me maximize the, you know, over a dozen products I already have, because I know I'm not doing a good job with that. But through the methods that I talked about today, I basically made a really comfortable living getting paid to create all that stuff. Now I'm sitting on a pile of content that I can convert into even more money, even more passively, without me having to do anything. So, you know, if that serves as a little more encouragement for people to get started right away, even while you're still learning, if you're committed to becoming a professional writer, that's something that's valuable that people will want to learn how to do, is follow in your footsteps.
Yeah. And for, you know, how you talked about your Facebook content, Ron shared this a while ago, and you probably know Colin, but I don't know if anybody else knows, but you can download all your Facebook posts, right?
Ron, yes, but not in groups.
Not in groups. It doesn't take the group content. You still have lots on your own personal that would be useful.
I do. I do. But one tip I would recommend, and I teach this to people who, like, I have a training about starting groups. One thing you can do is through, what's it called? Is it Zapier? That it's like a web app where you can set if-then statements.
Zapier. Yeah, I heard of Zapier.
Yeah, it's like Zapier, and there's another one called IFTT for if-then, if-this-then-that.
Yes.
But basically, you can set it so that it monitors your Facebook group, and every time a new post is posted, it will send you an email. So you can set up like a Gmail account just for your group, and it will collect emails for every post anyone makes, and it'll have a link to that post. Because what happens as the Facebook group fills up, the old stuff falls all the way to the bottom. And if the group is old enough, it can be impossible to scroll all the way to the bottom from 3 years ago, because it's tens of thousands of messages. And only recently has Facebook's group search started actually being any good. So it used to be really hard to find the old stuff. So either keep track of your own posts by saving the post URL yourself, like in a little spreadsheet or whatever. I'll usually, when I post something that I've composed like offline in the notes program or whatever, I'll just copy and paste the URL into the file so that I have like a folder of text files of all the things I've ever posted, and at the very top is a URL that if I click on it, it'll go to the page on Facebook where I posted it. Habit, that way you won't lose that archive of stuff, because if I had to go back manually and dig through the archive, it would be a pain. I wouldn't be able to do it.
Yeah, great tip.
Okay, well, I guess we'll wrap it up here, right? Or you
Sweet.
Got something else?
No, I'm all good.
All right. Well,
you'll
thanks
have
again,
to build
Colin.
Some Legos.
Yeah. Well, thanks everybody for coming, and thanks Ron and Alice for having me. And
thank you so much.
You guys have a great week.
All right, talk soon.
Bye-bye.